I'm excited about this next conversation because it's going to address some issues that I think are ignored and overlooked. You know, in the world of psychology and mental sciences and stuff, there's a lot of focus, and there needs to be, on things like ADD and ADHD and depression. And we've even had experts in the past on the show talking about the drugs associated with those issues and all that sort of stuff. But today we're going to talk about something a little bit different, and I think it's something that most of you will find very fascinating. We're going to be joined by Dr. Raphael Wald. He's an expert licensed psychologist and neuropsychologist. He has a range of expertise, including extensive work with athletes, adults, and children who have suffered major concussions and brain injuries, including those who suffer from, as I said, ADD, ADHD, depression, dyslexia, and other disorders. He has a doctorate of psychology and has worked at Harvard as a clinician. He has been published as the first author for the Journal of Experimental and Clinical Psychopharmacology. Oh, that's a word and a half. And has published a book focusing on the causes and treatments of obsessive compulsive disorder. Dr. Walden, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you, Josh?
I'm doing really, really well. Now, two of the issues that you cover, I think, are two issues that are overlooked because, you know, ADD, ADHD get a lot of attention, but dyslexia and obsessive compulsive disorder seem to be things that, because we don't view them as serious or threatening, we just kind of push them aside, but they're pretty relevant, aren't they?
Absolutely, and I think that there have been TV shows in the past that have made it be, especially with OCD, have made it be a kind of disorder that is cute or quirky, but it can be very debilitating. As with most psychological disorders, there's a whole range of severity that a person can experience. It can be kind of a minor problem, or it can make a person's life completely unlivable.
Well, you bring up a great point, and that's every time we see it in film and entertainment, it's always something to be laughed at, and it's something that's funny, which means we probably don't understand it in its entirety. What really is obsessive compulsive disorder?
Obsessive compulsive disorder is it's defined by two separate symptoms. Obviously, there are obsessions and compulsions. The obsessions really are a fixation on one idea or one fear. And in general, people just have an awful time trying to get that idea out of their minds. And a compulsion is an action that someone takes which is aimed at relieving that obsession. Sometimes it may be linked to that obsession in some way, and sometimes it's completely unrelated. So, for example, I'll give you a good example of something related. If a person has a fear of contamination and they obsess about being contaminated or becoming ill, they might wash their hands 25 times a day. Or it also might be completely unconnected. So, for example, if that same person has a fear of becoming contaminated, they might tap the doorpost 100 times before they leave the house.
Gotcha. And you suggested that these range in severity. What's a mild case? Because I'm sure everybody can come up with a severe case, like Jack Nicholson's character in that movie where he couldn't step on a line on the sidewalk and everything. But what does a mild case look like?
It's a funny thing you asked that. I want to answer the question by telling you that the two most self-diagnosed psychological problems are, in my opinion, OCD and ADHD. People always say, oh, I have OCD or I have ADHD. And in order to answer that question, you also have to understand that in order to have a psychological disorder, really by definition, it has to be interfering with your life. The way that the DSM or the Book of Psychiatric Disorders describes it is there has to be clinically significant distress. So a mild case would be something where it does cause some distress in your life, but it's not a massive amount of distress. So in other words, if you get out of the house 3 minutes later than you normally would, or 5 minutes later than you normally would because you checked the locks a few extra times, that might be something that's a more mild case. Obviously, a more severe case would be something where people's physical health or their medical health can be affected. So if a person is washing their hands 25, 30 times a day, and their hands are raw and chapped and the skin is coming off their hands, they become susceptible to infection and, you know, just generally can't use their hands at all for anything else.
Do you have any idea the amount of people or the percentage of the population that's affected by OCD?
Yeah, there have been a lot of different studies published, but for the most part, I'll give you a range. I'd say that the lifetime prevalence rate is probably somewhere between 1 and 4%, I'd say, which is a huge chunk of the population. If you think about it, that means if you line up 100 people, you know, up to 4 people have obsessive compulsive disorder.
Wow. And you suggested that it's the most self-diagnosed thing. I know everybody at some point says, oh, that's my OCD, and it's really not. Like, I have this thing where I can only eat one thing on a plate at a time, and that's not OCD, but we jokingly, you know, oh, that's my OCD. When people think they have it, is there also the other swing of that pendulum where they don't bother to acknowledge that they have it? Like, are there people who truly suffer with it but ignore it completely because of the humor or the connotation that comes with it?
Great question. More often than not with OCD, people generally recognize that their worries and their compulsions are out of proportion relative to what's going on in their real everyday lives, but they're completely incapable of stopping it. So there are some people who don't have a great deal of insight into it, but far more often than not, people understand that what they're doing is a little bit out of whack, so to speak.
Now, is there usually an age where this develops most prevalently? Because I know that there's some things that develop in, you know, your formational prepubescent years and stuff. Is there a range where we normally see this develop, or do we get it from birth?
It almost always develops before the age of 30. The way to think about it is, as with many psychological disorders, is that people are born with some kind of predisposition towards it. So a person is born with a predisposition, you know, a likelihood that they may develop obsessive compulsive disorder. And eventually some kind of a stress will come along that will trigger that and allow it to express itself. So that can happen to someone at the age of 3, and it can happen to someone at the age of 28. It just depends what the stress that comes along. For some people, that is struggling in school. For some people, it is trying some kind of illegal drug for the first time. Believe it or not, you know, just smoking pot one time is enough to trigger a psychiatric disorder in some people. And for some people, it's a divorce. So there's a whole range of things that can kind of kick the OCD into gear.
And how do we kick it out of gear? Are we pretty successful yet as a society or as a profession to kick this out of gear, or is this something that you just kind of manage for the rest of your life?
OCD is classified as an anxiety disorder. In general, anxiety is a problem where you worry too much. That's really the definition of anxiety, is it's excessive worry. So if you think about OCD, that's really what it is. It's excessive worry. You worry you're going to become contaminated. And in general, with anxiety disorders, we have treatments both in talk therapy and with medication that are very, very effective. In particular, with OCD, the way we treat it is through talk therapy. It's with a treatment called exposure with response prevention, which means that we help the patient come into contact.
Doctor, hold on 1 second. We're up against a break. Do you have time to stick around for one more segment? Because I'd like to get to dyslexia if we could.
Absolutely. You got it.
All right. Then we'll be back right after this. Don't go anywhere, folks. There's this organization called MAD. No, MAD. I messed up the joke. It's DAMN. And it's supposed to say, you know, Mothers Against Dyslexia. I hate it when I mess up a joke. That's what I get for thinking I'm funny. Anyway, we're talking to Dr. Wald. And our next topic is dyslexia. Dyslexia is one of those things that I believe is overlooked. And, Doctor, I'd like to get your input on this. I recently read a study that said 1 in 10 people actually have some form of dyslexia. Why do we overlook this one so much?
Yeah, dyslexia is very common, and I think the reason that it's overlooked so frequently is that you have to go to the right kind of a care provider in order to be diagnosed with dyslexia. So when we talk about psychiatrists and psychologists, each one has their own strengths and weaknesses. A psychologist or a neuropsychologist is a person who administers specific tests to help figure out what different problems your brain has in its thinking skills. So a psychologist or a neuropsychologist, preferably, is a person who can really tease out and say, okay, so this child is struggling in school not because they have ADHD, but because they have dyslexia, whereas a psychiatrist is very strong with prescribing medication. And a psychiatrist does not generally have the tools that a psychologist has in order to diagnose dyslexia. So if a person goes, so for example, you might have a child in school who is struggling, and people are looking and saying, you know, they're having a really hard time paying attention, it must be ADHD. Well, in actuality, what's going on is the reason they're having such a hard time paying attention is because they have dyslexia, so it's very hard for them to understand, and it's difficult to pay attention to something that you don't understand. Going to a psychiatrist, it might be diagnosed as ADHD, whereas in actuality it is dyslexia, and the psychologist would be able to point that out to you.
Now, you brought up paying attention to what you don't understand. Is it true that a lot of people don't understand dyslexia, and we think that it's always just people getting letters mixed up in words, but isn't it also other forms of, I don't know if confusion is the right word for it, but, you know, people can be mathematically confused or whatever?
Absolutely. That can be an associated feature of dyslexia. That can be a sign that someone may have dyslexia, that they put letters in the wrong order, that they write letters facing the wrong direction. But that's not the case with everyone with dyslexia. The way to think of dyslexia, or another name for the same disorder, is reading disorder. Same thing, is that it's really a language-based problem. So a person generally has problem reading language, and with some people that means they can't read the language fluently and clearly. They stumble on their words. For some people that means that they can read it fluently, but they have a hard time understanding what they're reading. So it's really, the best way to think of it is as a general language disorder.
And we talk about how it's overlooked. Why is the cause of this overlooked? I mean, wouldn't you think that parents would notice this in their children early on? I don't have any kids, so I don't know. But I would think that something like this would kind of present itself compared to some other disorders.
Yeah, I think they do. And again, it's tough because a lot of people don't even know the difference between a psychologist and a psychiatrist at all.
Right.
So going from there, I think, to a place where you say, okay, now I know that my child is struggling in school and my teachers are saying he can't pay attention, so how do I know where to go? How do I know how to deal with it? Because unfortunately, ADHD and dyslexia in the classroom can look exactly the same, but they have very, very different treatments.
You know, that's a really good point, because we seem to have, and this is, you know, kind of my take on it, but we seem to have almost like an ADD-ADHD epidemic, where if you jump around or get antsy in class, well, then you have to have ADHD, and it's just like this knee-jerk reaction to say everybody has it. How prevalent is ADHD really? Is it as mass prevalence as we think, or are there just other circumstances, or like dyslexia, other conditions that we're covering up in our knee-jerk reaction to say, oh, ADD?
The prevalence studies with ADHD are all over the board, and that's because there's been a massive increase in the number of people that are diagnosed with ADHD over the past 10 to 20 years, and I think there are a lot of different reasons for that. I think that one is that people are becoming more aware of ADHD. People are understanding that if they have ADHD, it does not in any way, and I want to clarify that having dyslexia or ADHD does not in any way mean that you're stupid. The two are unrelated. You can be extremely intelligent and have ADHD or dyslexia. But going back to what I was saying earlier is that I think there's an increasing awareness and an increasing acceptance of psychological and cognitive or thinking skill problems. And as people understand that it's more accepted, they're more willing to seek treatment. The other issue, unfortunately, is that the treatment of choice for ADHD is a stimulant medication, which is a controlled substance. And a lot of people don't realize this, but almost anyone, some people have strange reactions to medications, but almost anyone, whether they have ADHD or not, would benefit from a stimulant medication in that they would be able to focus a lot better. So I do think there are people out there that do not genuinely have ADHD that are seeking medication for the wrong reasons. It's a major problem in colleges and high schools. So I think those two things, the medication seeking in addition to the increase in awareness, I think those are really accounting for a jump in the prevalence of ADHD.
Well, you bring up a fascinating point, and that's the fact that most people would actually see a benefit to this sort of drug. And it raises the question then, well, if they would benefit from it, where do we draw that line of if you should or shouldn't? Because there's a lot of things we benefit from that we shouldn't take. And I know that in the military, they actually give pilots that mental stimulus sort of, I don't know what it's called, but they give them some form of drug, but it's illegal on college campuses. So we have that line somewhere. What defines that line of if you should or should not take it?
That's really something that your psychologist needs to answer for you. And there are a lot of wonderful teachers out there, a lot of wonderful school principals out there who are very good at recognizing when children have problems, but only a neuropsychologist or psychologist who has a great deal of experience in assessment can tell you if that medication is warranted based on your problems, and then your psychiatrist or primary care physician can prescribe the medication for you. It is a fairly serious medication because of the fact that it's addictive. It is in the same class. It's an amphetamine. These stimulant medications are amphetamines, which means that they're in the same class of medication as cocaine and methamphetamine. They're obviously much safer and better controlled because it's made by scientists and it's controlled by your doctor. But it's a serious medication.
Well, okay, so I have another question then. Are we seeing a rise in these sort of behavioral disorders, or did they just go unrecognized 100 years ago? Because 100 years ago, we didn't see this prevalence of ADD, dyslexia, ADHD. So is there actually a rise in it, or are we just getting better at detecting it? And if there is a rise in it, is it circumstantial, like environmental, or how? What constitutes the rise?
It's a very difficult thing to compare where we are now to where we were 100 years ago, because 100 years ago, now there's a much better acceptance of behavioral disorders, cognitive disorders, psychiatric disorders. Unfortunately, it's still really nowhere near where most mental health professionals would want it to be. I mean, you know, there's no reason that a psychological or psychiatric problem should not be covered by insurance exactly the same way that a medical problem is. You know, these are problems that are just like medical conditions. The same way you wouldn't blame a person for having a seizure disorder like epilepsy, how could you blame a person for having severe depression or an anxiety disorder? The treatments are obviously very different. So we're more accepting. We're not quite there. But 100 years ago, people with serious psychiatric problems like schizophrenia were either hidden in basements, chained to the walls in these horrible psychiatric institutions. Now we're more accepting than we used to be. So I think that as it becomes more and more accepted, people are more willing to come out and the prevalence rises.
Well, thank you, Doctor, for joining us. I'm going to give out the website for your clinic, pbpaonline.com.